everlasting God. Lord, here is our praise. Here is our worship. Come on, all over this room, just slip those heads in. Come on, let's give him a forever praise, a forever worship.
We will.
Come on, clap your hands right there. We worship your strong God. Hey, let's go. Say, oh, oh, oh.
Shout it out, shout it out, shout it out.
Can somebody shout the name of Jesus in this room? The one who fights all of our battles and wins every single one of them. Can you shout Jesus? Our strong tower, Jesus. We have the victory in you, Jesus. We have the victory in you, Jesus. It's an old song that says, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. If you know it, can you sing with me? We have the victory. Oh, in the name of Jesus, precious name of Jesus. This is the part I need everybody to sing real loud. Satan, you have to. Just for 5 seconds, can you shout Jesus? Come on, angels bow before him, heaven and earth. Can you shout Jesus? Sickness can't stay where he is. Shout Jesus. Come on. Come on, your sickness can't stay where the name is. Your issue can't stay where the name is. Can you shout Jesus? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. The more I call him, the better I feel. Jesus, Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's healing in the name. Shout Jesus. Your victory's coming. Your healing's coming. Your miracle's coming. But first you gotta say the name that's above every name. Come on, shout Jesus. There's nobody like you, Jesus. Nobody like you, Jesus. The more I call, the better I feel. Jesus. My Jesus. Come on, can you lift up your hands? Close your eyes and just begin to pull on the name. Come on, shout Jesus. Something about the name Jesus. Something about the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. Say something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name of Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Oh, it is the sweetest.
It's the sweetest name.
Can you just wave your hands like this? Wave your hands, wave your hands.
Oh. Oh, how I love you.
is something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus. Just like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Let all heaven and earth proclaim that kings and kingdoms shall all pass away. But there is something. When the doctor looks back at your report, they're going to be confused. But there is something about that name. Come on, can you just shout Jesus one more time? Be all glory, be all honor, be all praise. He deserves it. Come on, can you just shout Jesus in this room? Lord, remind us who you are. Remind us that you're the Savior. Remind us that you are Lord. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. So our response to that is our praise. Come on, can you lift up your hands all over this room? Just begin to lift up a praise. If you don't know what to say, can you say hallelujah? Say, Lord, I love you. Say, Lord, I bless you. The King of glory. You spoke those words, let there be light, and there was. And in that same breath, the stars fell in line with one voice, creation cries, you do all things well. You do all things well. So be praised. Be praised forever and always. You get the glory, Jesus. You get the glory. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Lost in the dark, under the dirt, I was very left to die. I heard your voice calling my name, from the tomb I came alive. You do all things well, from the tomb I came alive. You do all things well. Hallelujah. Hey, hey. Hallelujah. Somebody just shout hallelujah. Say how he never let me.
How he never let me fall. Now unto him who is able.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, let there never be a
day. Let there never be a day that I don't rise to bring you grace.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, remind us. Can we sing it again? Sing, when I think of all.
When I think of all.
Lift up a hallelujah in this room. Hey, see how he never let me.
How he never let me.
No, it's
him.
We
sing
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We got one more song of praise. Can you help us? See,
let there never be a
day. Sing it, sing, be praying, be praying, be praying, sing forever. From the front to the back, can you stretch those hands, say, be praying. Forever and always. One more time. Can we raise it again? Just voices. Be praying. He inhabits this. He lives in this. Say, be praying. Somebody wave your hands when you think about the goodness of Jesus. How he never let me.
How he never let me fall. Now unto him who is able.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So let there never be.
Let there never be a day that I don't rise.
We gotta go, but somebody gotta shout. Hallelujah. Let there never be.
Let there never be.
I don't rise to bring you
praise.
Hey, hey, hey. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody needs a reminder. Just take a few seconds to think. Say, when I think of all.
Let there never be.
See
hallelujah, hallelujah. You get the glory to you. You get the honor. Come. It belongs to you. It belongs to you. See, see, hallelujah. But mine is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
Come on and give God the highest praise in the room. Come on, lift your voice like a trumpet. Come on, let God know you appreciate all that He has done, all that He is doing. God, if it were not for you, I don't know where I would be. Come on, somebody gonna say hallelujah. It belongs to you. Come on, say hallelujah. Come on, He deserved the highest praise. Come on.
Lift your hands in this place. Come on, lift your voice. Lift your voice. Say something to him. Anybody thankful in this place? Come on, you owe Him this one. 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 Out of all the ways He's made, out of all the doors He's opened, you owe Him this one. Come on, give it to Him. Come on, come on. Break open your alabaster box and pour it on Him. Say, God, I thank You for life, for health, for strength. God, I owe You this one. Come on, come on. Come on, tell Him thank You for all the ways You made. Come on. Hallelujah.
So many doors You've opened. So many ways You made. So many doors You've opened. So many ways You made. So many doors You've opened. So many ways You made. So many doors You've opened. So many ways You've made. So many times You've healed me. You've been better than good to me. So many doors You've opened. So many ways You've made. So many times. Say, You've been better than good to me. Say so.
So many doors You've opened.
So many times.
So many times.
Say this. You've been better than good to me.
Better than good to me.
I can count the ways You bless me. So many times. Hey, You've been better than good. Can we raise it? Say so.
So many times.
So many ways.
So many times.
You feel me. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. You healed my body. You freed my mind. You've been my keeper. Oh, you've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. Hands raised and say, you sing it. You've been so, nobody can tell it like You can tell it. So You've been so good. Come on, sing it louder. You've been so, You've been so good. I can never repay You because the way You changed my life. You've been so good. Cause You've been so good. You've been so good. Can you just take 5 seconds to think about it? You've been.
Zion, to him. So good.
So to me. To won't stop being good. And you won't stop being. And you won't stop being good. You won't stop being good.
Zion, can you put your hands together and just applaud him? Can you appreciate him? Come on, can you just appreciate him? God, I'm thankful. Not only am I thankful, but I'm grateful for all that you have done. Anybody know that if it had not been for the Lord who was on your side,
I could never repay you, Lord, for what you've done for me. How you loose my shackles. How you set me free. How you made a way when there was no way. How you made a way when there was no way to. You've been better than good to me.
Somebody lift your hands. God, we thank you. God, we thank you. As a chorus of your children, God, we tell you thank you. Thank you, Lord, for making a way where there was no way. Thank you, Lord, for healing the body when the doctor turned his head and said he couldn't do anything else. Thank you, Lord, for being our lawyer. Thank you, Lord, for being our buckler. Thank you, Lord, for being our defender. God, you've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. So God, we don't have a lot of money. God, we don't have a lot of prestige. But we do have a thankfulness in our hearts. And so we say thank you in spite of. God, we say thank you in spite of what the enemy's doing. In spite of what we don't have. God, we have a praise in our hearts. And so God, we give you glory. God, we give you worship. God, we give you praise. You are worthy of glory and honor. God, we love you. God, we appreciate you in all that you do, in all that you have done, in all that you're about to do. God, we give you praise, oh, credit for what you're about to do, the door that you're about to open, the way that you're about to make. God, do your good work. God, do your good work. God, we take our hands off of it. And God, we release you into our children and into our future. God, do your good work. God, your reputation is good with us. God, do what only you can do. God, heal like only you can heal. God, deliver like only you can deliver. And we give you glory in advance. And we give you praise in advance for what you're about to do. Your promises are yay, and they are amen. God, we get in alignment with your will for our lives. God, we release you into every household, into every family, into every marriage. God, get in and do what only you can do. We bind the enemy and his works. Get out of God's children. Get out of our business. You're trespassing. This is God's property. We command you to go. We command you to flee. God, come in and flood this place with your glory and your anointing. Don't let us leave here the way that we came. Don't let us leave here with the same burdens. Don't let us leave here with our mind weighed down. God, we decree and we declare that by the time we leave this place, somebody's going to get an answer. Somebody's going to be healed. Somebody's going to be delivered. And so, God, we give you glory ahead of the miracle. We send Judah first. We send Judah first. God, do it. Do the miraculous. Do the impossible. And we'll be careful to give you glory. And we'll be careful to give your name honor, because it all belongs to you. It all belongs to you. God, we won't take your glory. God, we won't take your honor. But we'll heave it up to you, because it all belongs to you. In the only name that heals. In the only name that delivers. In the only name that sets free. The matchless, perfect name of Jesus Christ. Somebody give God glory in the room right now. I didn't say clap like a seal. I said give him glory. Open up your mouth and give him glory. Open up your mouth and give him glory. Give his breath back to him. It's his breath in your lungs. Come on, give him glory in this room. God, we glorify you. God, we glory for you. May be seated if you can. But on your way down, say, God is good. And his mercy endures forever. God bless you. Turn your attention to the screen.
And you won't stop being good.
Hey, family, it's not too late. You can still sign up for the best summer ever. It's the best summer camp ever. Every week, you can sign up for a brand new theme, brand new field trip. It's only $175 per week. You won't want to ever leave. Remember, if you want to register your child or sign up to be a camp counselor, just go to overcomerkids.com. We hope that you get there. We'll see you soon. Bye. World Overcomers, it is back to school time. You know what that means? We have three collection bins at the church, two in the lobby, one in the main office. We're collecting school supplies for three area schools: CC Spalding Elementary, Bethesda Elementary School, and Neal Middle School. We are in need of book bags, paper, notebooks, pens, pencils, markers, erasers. Please donate to the school supply bins that are in the lobby or the office. On Saturday, August 6th, we have partnered with Walmart in Briar Creek to bring you a Stuff the School Bus school supply drive. That's right, we will park an entire school bus right outside of Walmart in hopes that we fill it up with school supplies. So please come and please donate. On August 7th, that will be the last day we will be collecting donations for our bins that are inside the lobby for our three area schools. That's Bethesda Elementary, CC Spalding Elementary, and Neal Middle School. Please come out, please donate to these schools that are in need of all these school supply items for the school year.
Would you look to your left and to your right and tell them there's a miracle in this room? I need you to say it with some authority. There's a miracle in this room. I need you to say it with some power. There's a miracle in this room. Come on, tell somebody else. There's a miracle in this room. Now look around and tell somebody. It's got your name all over it. It's got your name all over it. It's got your name all over it. Whatever you've been waiting for, the miracle has got your name. The ground has been tilled. All you have to do at this point is sow a seed of praise, sow a seed of thanksgiving, sow a seed of glory, sow a seed of hallelujah. I dare you to lift up your hand and shout glory. Hey. All right. All right. One more time, it feel like church in here. Why don't you lift your hand and shout glory? Come on, do it. I heard him saying to Koji Church that we'll do it one time for the Father. Lift your hand and shout glory. Now let's do it one more time for the Son. Lift your hand and shout. Now only if you got the Holy Ghost, I want you to jump up on your feet, throw your hands up and shout glory. Come on, if you got it, I should feel something more than that. If you got it, there should be a shaking in this room. If you got it, there should be a movement in this room. Let the enemy know you tried, but God is ahead. God won. God did it. And we have the victory. Let me hear you shout. All right. Y'all can be seated. That's what happens. When you go to sleep and the word is on YouTube and the preacher's preaching, and I woke up and I heard Bishop Jake screaming, till the ground. I woke up, I was looking for my wife. She was still downstairs watching TV. And I heard Bishop Jake say, till the ground, till the ground. And I'm in the bed at 3 o'clock in the morning talking about till the ground. Well, he sent them folks into a praise. He said, you can't look for a miracle and not till the ground and prepare for a miracle. And I was like, how are we supposed to till the ground, Bishop? Bishop said, you till the ground with a praise. You till the ground by clapping your hands. You till the ground by stomping your feet. You till the ground by letting the enemy know, yep, it was almost over. Yep, you almost had me. Yep, you almost made me doubt it. But I'm tilling.
You got to work on it. You can't believe God for a miracle and not prepare for it. You can't believe God to do wonderful things and not prepare for it. You've got to till the ground. Move your feet, till the ground. Clap your hands, till the ground. Run around and till the ground. Let the enemy know, you won't stop me. You won't stop me. You won't stop me. You won't stop me. I'm tilling the ground. I'm sowing my seed. I'm making room. I'm making room. I'm making room. I know I'm going to give you the announcements, but I'm telling you, there's a rich anointing in this room. And you can say you want it, but you've got to till the ground. Because when it comes to your house, you have to know what to do with it. And you got to get the ground ready. That's right. Let the enemy know, my ground is getting ready for what's about to come to my house. Miracles, signs, wonders, salvation, healing, overflow. It's all on its way to your house. Do you believe it's on its way to your house? Do you believe it's on its way to your house? Do you believe it's on its way to your... Pastor Joey, there's miracles in this room. And this is a great moment. Because not only are we going to give our money, but we're going to till the ground. And we're going to let the enemy know every seed I sow, it's about to produce a harvest. Every dollar I give, it's about to produce a harvest. Anybody feel like that this morning? $1,000 going to turn over 10,000 times. Oh, y'all can't see that? $1,000 going to turn over 10,000 times. And if you believe God's about to do that for you, I need you to till the ground for your house. I need you to till the ground for what God's about to do. Increase in my home. Increase on my job. Increase in my family. Overflow for my children. Debt paid off. Tuition, free ride. Scholarships and bonuses. Checks in the mail. Finding money. Royalties received. Unexpected gifts. Surprises, ideas that create personal wealth, expedited, hurry up money, expedited, hurry up money, expedited, hurry up money, expedited, hurry up money, hurry up money, hurry up money, it's on its way, it's on its way, it's on its way. I want everybody to stand. Some of you need to give $1,000 right now. Don't stop your praise here. That $1,000 is about to open up the door for your next million. If you're watching us online, I'm talking to you. The QR code is about to pop up. I know it's a little different, but the Lord has need of you. And he's trying to get something to you. And because you tilled the ground this morning, in your living room, you were stomping and getting the soil ready for what God's about to do. As you sow that $1,000 this morning, God's going to return it. Listen, I got news for you. You sow it now, you'll see it in 24 hours. You'll get a letter. You'll get confirmation. God will send somebody to you to let you know, yep, I was thinking about you. I got to give something to you. I've got to give you favor. I've got to open up a door. Yep, $1,000. There's some of you in this room right now. You was jumping. Because you know God's about to do something for you. Don't get nervous. This is a good time right here. God's about to do something amazing for you. If you believe that, would you receive it? Would you receive it now? If you need an offering, wave your hand. These guys will serve you. That's right, $1,000. Don't sleep on it. God's about to do something great in here. God's about to do something. But sometime we've got to pull on our faith a little bit more. And this morning I'm pulling on you to sow. Sow $1,000. He said, Pastor Tyrus, I don't have 1,000, but I got 500. Make eye contact. And two of you give $1,000. I'm telling you what I know. The first $1,000 seed opened up a door for me that has had an unstoppable flow. And I'm speaking that for you this morning. There'll be an unstoppable flow. Oh, yeah, there'll be an unstoppable flow. $1,000 is just a door open. It's just a door open. I want you to give it online. As you're giving it, just go ahead and say, an unstoppable flow, an unstoppable flow. As you're in this room and you're giving $1,000. Don't look at me like that. You belong in this room right now. You belong online with us right now. You're in the right place
for God to open up something for you. I'm telling you what I know. We want God to double our blessing. We want God to double our income. We want God to double our increase. Why don't you give to it and watch God? Give and watch God. Give. I see you still giving. That's why I'm not going to move. Give and watch God. Give and watch. Don't be nervous. $1,000 ain't nothing. Huh? You scared of $1,000? Then what you going to do when $1 million hit your account? If you're scared of $1,000, you're going to be scared of $10,000. If you're scared of $10,000, you're going to be scared of $100,000. If you're scared of $100,000, you're going to pass out when you see $1 million. But I believe this is the season for us. Somebody say us. Somebody say us. Somebody say us. Somebody say us. This is the season for us. We're going to lead in giving. And we're going to lead in prosperity. We're going to lead in giving, and we're going to lead in overflow. We're going to lead in giving, and we're going to lead in giving. Oh, y'all missed that one. We're going to lead in giving to the kingdom, and we're going to lead in giving to others. Uh-huh. We're blessed to be a blessing. Those of you who didn't give $1,000, that's okay. Give $100. Give $500. Give. Get your phones out. There's a QR code on the back of your seats. I want you to give in this moment right here. I know you're used to sitting down and we have our routine and the praise team comes. But no, if you want God to do something different, you got to do something different. And this is the different. We tilled the ground. Now we sow our seed. And we look for a harvest of what we're sowing. Business owners, you need to sow right now. You own your own business, you need to be sowing right now. You own your own nonprofit, you need to be sowing right now. I'm telling you what I know. Don't be bigger on the internet than you are in the kingdom. God gave you exposure so that you can bless his house. Now bless his house. Bless his house. Bless his house. It's a good day. Father, we thank you because not only do we tithe in obedience to your word and understanding of the scripture, but we sow in faith, withholding nothing, because we realize 1,000 is just a drop in the bucket for really what you want to do for us. But God, we're taking that first step. We've tilled the ground. There's some people online that are sowing that $1,000 for the very first time. God, they've never sown this big in their whole Christian experience. And God, I'm thanking you right now that they will have the testimony that I was on WOCC's YouTube page. I sowed this seed and God blessed my socks off. God, for everyone that's in this room that's sowing this morning, God, we've never seen the righteous forsaken. His seed has never begged for bread. And God, as we sow, as marketplace ministers, God, right now, we have the blessings in our mouth. So we command it according to Deuteronomy 8 and 18. You've given us the power to get wealth. We tilled the ground. We sowed our seed. Now we take authority with the power that we have and we lay hold of the wealth that the sinner is holding, but it's laid up for the righteous. God, we thank you for it now. Do you believe wealth is coming to your house? Then why don't you clap your hands like you know it's on its way? Why don't you clap your hands like you know it's on your way? Come on, wealth is on its way. It's on its way. It's on its way. As the buckets pass, you keep standing on your feet. We're going to continue in worship, and the next voice you'll hear is that of our senior pastor, Pastor Andy Thompson.
Praise the Lord, we believe that anything is possible when we praise him. Come on, you just gave, come on. Now let's praise, come on. Clap those hands right here if you believe it. See, anything is possible.
God will
everything we speak. not afraid of giants.
Not afraid of giants.
Because they always fall. Let's beat this by faith. All my fear is gone away. Say,
all my fear is gone away.
Every day we walk. See, we have overcome.
We have already won.
You've given us the victory,
Lord.
You supply our
faith.
Come on, remind them, say, we've got history. We can speak to mountains, and they have to move.
Power and authority
comes from you. So shout if you believe. Till every wall comes down. Shout because you know that.
Shout because you know.
He's still living, moving, breathing, and he's still doing miracles, and it's happening now. Let's sing this. Sing nothing. Sing all things. He's still working, and it's happening now. Sing nothing. We believe it. Sing he's still working.
I believe in miracles. I believe he's a miracle working God. Can you put your hands together and bless him? If you believe he's a miracle working God, way make a miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
That is who you are.
Glory, Jesus. I believe in miracles. I believe they are possible. Happening now. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. We want to welcome all of you, name by name, person by person, to World Overcomers Christian Church, to our 10 o'clock service. Hallelujah. This Sunday morning, welcome to the presence of the Lord. Is this almost the last Sunday in July? Is it the last Sunday? Is it the second to last Sunday? What is this, the last Sunday? It's the second to last Sunday in July. August is on the way, and we
We want to welcome every one of you that made it. Some of us came to church just to get the air conditioned. Hallelujah. And we're turning it up for you, and we're trying to make sure you're cool. And let me tell you something right now. If you live in anywhere, really, just about anywhere in America, you should be reassured that you do not want to go to hell, because it is hot out there, my God. And if there's anybody that ought to praise God, it is us, because we know we're on our way to heaven and we're glad about it, but we're excited. And we want to welcome all of you, name by name, person by person, to World Overcomers, to our 10 a.m. service. If you're watching live stream around the world, welcome. So excited that you tuned in with us. We know that there are so many ministries that you could be tuning into, and the fact that you're with us this morning, we are honored. And we just want you to let us know you're a first-time visitor. You're in the room with us this morning. You decided to come to church. You decided that you were glad when they said, let's go to the house of God. You decided to get up and get in your car. You decided to take a bath, take a shower, brush your teeth. You decided to put some deodorant on, oh hallelujah, and throw on some cologne and some perfume. And you decided to come to the house of the Lord and be in the presence of the Lord with us. And there's something about being God's presence. And so thank you for coming to worship with us. And if you're with us for the very first time, on the way out of that door, there's a connection point there. And if you go there and say, I'm a first-time visitor, they'll give you something from us just to thank you for coming. If you're watching live stream, let us know. We'll thank you for coming. World Overcomers is a young church. We're 19 years old, and God has given us this vision, balanced victory for the God-designed life. And what that simply means is that we're asking for the intervention of God. Anybody asking for the intervention of God? Anybody trust in the intervention of God? Meaning, I want God to intervene. I want God to stick his hand in my dough. I want God to put his presence in my life. And I want my life to reflect the intervention of God. I don't just want church to reflect the intervention of God. I want my life. I want the stuff I've got. I want people to be able to clearly acknowledge that God's hand is on my life. I want to believe that God's behind it. I want to believe that God has a plan for me. I want to believe that God has a plan for you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. I want to believe the sickness got to get out of you. I want to believe that prayer works. I want to believe that God can touch you wherever you may be. I want to believe that God is still involved in this thing called life. And I want him to design my life, not just rescue my life. He has rescued my life, and I'm never going back, but I want him to now design my life and talk to me, give me a plan on a regular basis. I'm saying, God, talk to me. Tell me what to do. Tell me where to go. Tell me who to trust. Tell me who to not talk to. Give me a word. Speak to my life and give me clarity, and help me to know how to avoid the pitfalls that have jacked me up until this point. And I want God to be the architect of my life. And we know there's so many ministries, and we're honored that you're here with us this morning. And as you can see, we came to worship the Lord and bless him, and we've praised him, and we've hollered, and we've given. And now I want us to turn to the scriptures and see what God would say to us today. And so we're excited that you're with us. We trust you sense the presence of God, and I trust you're ready to hear a word from the Lord. I do have a word for you. I trust that you were moved and blessed to praise the Lord. And I trust that you praised him just a little bit, because the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my life is changed, and I will praise him. And my heart greatly rejoiceth, and with my song will I praise him. And I've praised him, and you've praised him. And now we're in his presence, and let's hear what he would say to us this morning. How many have a Bible with you, an iPad or device? Throw something above your head, wave something at really quickly. All right, let's look at the Word of God together. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter number 6. We have been looking at Old Testament scriptures, and I've been doing a series called Sunday School, Back to the Basics, or Revelation from the Basics. Really, I could call the series True Laws, because we really have been focusing on true laws. I'm going to talk about a little bit of that some this morning. But Genesis chapter 6, and then Mark chapter 3. If you could just jump on your feet with me for just a moment. It's become our custom to stand for the reading of the Word of God. It's 11 o'clock. Let's jump into the Word really quickly. Give me 40 minutes, and we'll share a word with you. And we'll be out of here a little early. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter number 6, and beginning in reading in verse number 5, reading out of the NIV. Thank you for standing on your feet. You can look on the screens and read along with us if you're not prepared. Let's go. Genesis 6, 5 says, "The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. And the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, I'm going to wipe out everybody from the face of the earth, the human race I've created, and with them the animals and the birds and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I even made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord." Verse 22 said, "Noah did everything just as God commanded him." And Mark chapter 3 and verse 24. Mark 3, 24. Once again, reading out of the NIV. And once again, you can look on the screens and read along with us if you're not ready. It's okay. Mark 3, 24. Jesus is talking. And Jesus says, "If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand." Title of my message this morning is Sunday School. Noah, the responsibility of favor. Noah, the responsibility of favor. Bow your head, let me pray for you. Lord, I pray that as we close our eyes and open up our hearts, we pray that you will speak to us. As we center in for a minute, as we disconnect from phones, as we disconnect from social media, as we attune our ears to your word and to your voice, as we do it in the room, as we do it around the world, from our apartments, from our houses, from our movie rooms, from our kitchens, as we dial in to hear a word from you, we ask you to speak to us. Speak to our hearts, Holy Spirit. Speak to our minds, wisdom of God, and have your way in us. Kingdom of God, come in this moment. Will of God be done in us. And we'll praise you for what you do, what you say. You're so worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. We all said together, amen. We all said together, amen. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. Noah, the responsibility of favor. If I can turn your attention to Mark chapter 3, those two verses that we just read, Mark chapter 3 and verse 24 and 25, and Jesus says, "If a kingdom is divided against itself, cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, it cannot stand." I love the Lord. Anybody love the Lord in here? I love the Lord. Back in the day, they used to say, "I love the Lord. And if loving God is wrong, I don't want to be right." I love the Lord. Not only do I love the Lord because he heard my cry, but I also love church. I love when we gather together. I love the fact that folk can come together across different generations, across different experiences. I'm glad that so many of us, different ages and different genders and different cultures and different experiences and different places that we're from, I'm glad we can come together. I'm glad we can tune in together. I'm glad that technology has allowed us to tune in together. I'm glad that right now this broadcast can reach around the world as a result of technology. I'm glad that you came together. I'm glad that you are able to sit in a service with somebody so that you'll know you're not the only one who's had a miracle happen in your life. You're not the only one that needs God and his intervention. You're not the only one that life may be attacking. You're not the only one that may be dealing dealing with trouble. There's something about us gathering together and lifting holy hands together and praising God together. There's something about that that helps you to know that you're not by yourself. Almost nothing as disturbing or as distressing or depressing than thinking you're the only one going through what you're going through. But if you are facing a challenge, you're not by yourself. If there's somebody in your life you love that's sick, you're not by yourself. If you've got somebody to pray for, you're not by yourself. If you need prayer in here, you are not by yourself. If you need a miracle in this room, you have come to the right place. Somebody better talk to me in this hot room. If you are in a place right now where you're thinking, if God don't do it, it's not going to get done. If the Lord don't move, I need a miracle, and it's happening now. When you come together, when you tune in and you see all the comments, when that happens, you realize you're not by yourself. You're not alone. I love the Lord. He heard my cry. I love gathering together for church. I love it. I've been in church my whole life. I was made to go to church. I went when I didn't have a choice. I went because I wouldn't get to eat if I didn't go. I went because my parents wouldn't let me live with them if I didn't go to church. I'm saved because they made me be saved. I'm saved because I had no choice but to be saved. And it taught me to love God, and it taught me to love church, and I love the kingdom. But I will say, as a church boy, as a bishop's son, as a fourth generation preacher, I will say, as much as I love church, we have to continually strive to find the balance. Something about church, something about the Bible, something about the Word of God, something about the allure of the Spirit. If you're not careful, it can make you so spiritually minded that you're no earthly good. You can be so caught up in the spirituality of your moment that you miss the fact that there may be something practical that you're missing that is a factor in whether or not you are successful or not. Everything is not a demon. Oh, help us, Holy Ghost. Everything is not the devil. There's a lot of stuff that is the devil, but everything is not the devil. And if you come here and worship and praise and holler, and we will call on God and ask for the intervention of God. But when we look at the scriptures, I'm going to try to help you as best I can to acknowledge that you do have some responsibility when it comes to where you are in your current moment. And as much as the enemy may attack you, the Bible says that if we resist the devil, he'll flee from us. And so we have to acknowledge that some of what we're dealing with is us. Love God, but also you better love your neighbor. Believe, but you better do some work, because faith without works is dead. So as much as you believe God, you also better get up tomorrow. Praying on a Sunday is awesome, but tomorrow get up, take a shower, and put your clothes on, and go to work, go to school, read your book, do your work, because God is not about to miracle you a job that you are not skilled for. Matter of fact, don't nobody in here want a doctor working on you that it's a miracle that they're a doctor. Nobody wants a dentist working on them. Nobody wants anybody handling their money that says, I really don't know what I'm doing, but God. We actually want qualified people to actually service us. So we have to be careful about our definition of favor. this passage, Pastor Al, we were just talking about it. This passage, this Mark 3:24 passage, that if a house, if a kingdom is divided against itself, it can't stand. And if a house is divided against itself, it cannot stand. If you're familiar like me, and maybe you're not, maybe you didn't grow up in any of this, but I'm going to address this for those of us who were. Somehow, this passage of scripture got applied to fighting demons. This was a passage that we talked about, this passage, Pastor Tony, a lot when it came to binding a strong man, and it's because they're saying that Jesus is possessed by Beelzebub. So somehow, because they're talking about Jesus being possessed by a devil, and then Jesus says, what are y'all talking about? I'm possessed by a devil. So what y'all are saying is that I'm driving out Satan by the power of Satan. What are you talking about? If a kingdom divided against itself, can I stand? If a house is divided against itself, it cannot stand. He goes on to say in verse 26 that if Satan opposes himself and is divided against himself, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter the strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. For many of us, that passage was applied to binding the strong man. So that means you got to bind the devil, and you got to bind the demon, and you got to bind. But I would like to suggest, not to contradict any of its spiritual application, but I would like to suggest a more practical application of these words that Jesus is communicating. And I would like to suggest, my brothers and sisters in the room and around the world for your consideration, that the strong man that Jesus is talking about tying up is agreement. Jesus is saying that one of the ways to plunder somebody is to tie their agreement up. That you can't plunder a strong man's house without first tying him up. And so one of the ways that plunder happens, one of the ways that death takes place, one of the ways that a people or a community or a group is destroyed or hurt or taken advantage of, is that their agreement is bound. So Jesus is saying, listen, if anything's got to be loosed, it's got to be agreement. If we got to bind on earth and it be bound in heaven, and loose on earth and be loosed in heaven, then agreement is something that has to be set free. In all of our praying for God to set stuff free, one of the things that we have to ask God to free is agreement. Because a kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. A house divided against itself cannot stand. Let's not quickly move on, and let's not replace the practical application of it by being overly spiritual in our reading of the passage. In essence, what Jesus is saying, and we talked about this a little bit last Sunday, but in essence, what Jesus is saying is that agreement is required. Whether you saved or not, agreement is required. Whether you know God or not, agreement is required. I would actually contend that if you have agreement and don't have God, you may still have more power than people who don't have agreement and do know God. It's absolutely possible for somebody to not know God like you know God, have agreement, and have more power than you. As a matter of fact, sad as it is possible to be in agreement about something wrong and have more power than people that are in disagreement about something right. Oh, my Lord, I'm just going to move on really quickly. But what I'm saying to you is, whether you're in the room or whether you're watching this around the world, you don't have to be saved. You don't have to be a Christian. You don't even have to be a kingdom person. You can take these words that I'm saying right now and apply them right now to your everyday life. You want to have power in your company? You're going to have to get people to agree. You're only going to have but so much power in your company if everybody's just scared of you and everybody's just submitting and everybody's just running for their life. If you really want to have power, agreement is the thing that is ultimately the point. You got to have agreement. You want to have power in your marriage? Well, it'd be good if you agree. Well, what's the Bible say about submission? Well, submission only happens when you don't agree. And the Bible doesn't say that submission is empowered. The Bible says that submission is required when agreement is not there. But if you want to have power and you want to have anointing, it'd be good to have agreement. You can have your children under your thumb as long as you want, but when they reach a certain age, they need to agree with you that it's time to come in the house. They need to agree with you that a curfew makes sense, because you can only watch them but so much, and you'll turn your house from a castle to a prison if you don't have agreement. I'd much rather you be a king and a queen than a warden. And I have been both, hallelujah. But I would rather you be a king and a queen. The way for you to be a king and a queen is for your teenagers and your young adults that live with you to be princes and prince and princess. And for them to do that, they have to agree with the royal edict and with what makes sense. But if they have too much disagreement with you and are still going to live with you, then inevitably you will have to put them in jail. And you'll have to monitor them and watch them and chase them and track them down with Life 360 and figure out where they are all the time, because you can't trust them, and you can't trust them because you don't agree together. If a nation's going to have power, it's got to agree. Company's going to have power, it's got to agree. Nothing worse than having a business and got people that work for you that aren't in agreement with your goal. I was in a store recently. I can't remember which store it was. I can't remember who it was. I don't want to say it because I don't want to hurt anybody's business. But I tried to pay for my burger with a $100 bill, and they would not take my $100 bill. And I thought, y'all must be crazy. Whoever started, if you are in this room and you have a plan to start a business, or you have a business that you are just started, or you got a side hustle, if you are just getting it going, if somebody hands you $100, you holla hallelujah. You don't tell nobody. You have a policy where you don't receive money, legal tender. That is a sign that somebody is making a decision at a lower level that's going to affect the CEO's business. Let me just move on. What I'm saying is if you're going to have power in your corporation, you got to get your employees to agree with you. We said last Sunday, if you're going to have power in a church is about agreement. A part of the reason why we worship and praise God and holler and sing is because we're all trying to agree that God is worthy to be praised. We're not here to be entertained. No, I'm going to say that again. We're not here to be entertained. This is not a show. We cannot compete for your show dollars. We cannot compete for your recreation dollars. Church cannot be a recreational show that you partake of to make your week better. Well, I need a witness in the building. We can't become such consumers that we miss the point of this. The point of this 2 hours is not for you to be impressed. It's not for you to be like, "Woo, they can sing." Believe me, we want to put somebody up here that actually can sing, but what we really want you to do is raise your own hands and open up your own mouth. I need to see a hand go up. And for you to put your own hands together and for you to think for just a second, you know what? God has been good to me. And for you to think, you know what? I do owe him my life. And for you to think the Lord is my strength and my shield and my heart does trust in him. Shouldn't be that hard for the people on this stage to get you to worship God, because you're a walking miracle. I said you're a walking miracle. I said you're a walking miracle. I said you are a walking miracle. No, y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. I said you're a walking miracle. I said that if it had not been for God on your side, you don't know where you'd be. You better talk to me. If the Lord had not made a way for you, you don't really know where you'd be. If God had not done it, you wouldn't even be here. Many of you, you ought to be crazy. Talk to me. You ought to be out of your mind. You ought to be locked up. You ought to be jacked up. But God decided to make a way for you, but God somehow shielded your mind from what made everybody else in your family crazy. Some of you are the only sane person in your family, and it's not you, it's God. So when we come together, when you tune in, this ain't Netflix, baby. Put your spatula down in the kitchen and raise your hands and be like, oh no, God, slap your babies and say, wait. We got to praise the Lord, because without the Lord, we wouldn't have this house. Without the Lord, we wouldn't have this job. Without the Lord, you wouldn't have them shoes. Without the Lord, you wouldn't have that popsicle. Without God, we wouldn't have made it. No, I'm going to look around for just a minute, because I want to see who's in the room with me right now, because I know I got some white folk in here, and thank you for coming. But black people, if it had not been for God on our side, we would not have made it. Your great-grandmama and your grandmama worshiped through her pain. Our ancestors only made it through slavery because they were able to gather together and lift up holy hands and say, God, I love you anyway. God, I love you no matter what they've done. Lord, I haven't seen my baby because they sold them. The only reason why your mama made it is because she had a little talk with Jesus and she believed that life would get better. And I don't know about you, but I believe life is going to get better. I speak it in the room while I'm trying to preach on Noah. What's coming is better than what's been. And let your grandmama shout through you. And let your ancestor praise through you. Y'all shouldn't have no real problem praising God in here. And y'all are some of the loudest people at the party. So don't you dare shout more in a club. Oh my God. If you were the first one twerking, if you was the main one in the middle, if you was the main one backing it up, don't you dare give more praise to your flesh. I need everybody to say something really quickly. Stop acting like y'all are quiet. All right, you may be seated. I just want to make sure that we're able to agree, because agreement is required. Church is only going to be as strong as how much we're able to agree. The reason why y'all are all facing forward, and I've studied and prayed and fasted and talked to God to say something to you, is not to oppress you with my theological acumen or my vocabulary or to entertain you in some way. Hopefully you'll hear something that'll bless you. Maybe you might laugh a little bit, but that ain't the point. The point is for us to hear something and say amen. Amen means so let it be, but amen and nodding also means, you know what? I agree with what this guy might be crazy, but he's making a good point. I agree with this. This is true, because the point of church is agreement. may not like the denominations. I grew up in a denomination, but part of the point of the denominations, we're a non-denominational church, but a part of it is they agree. You agree. Because agreement is required. Agreement is anointed. Agreement is not easy to achieve. Talk to me. Agreement is not easy to achieve. Anybody that's older than 10 knows that agreement is not easy to achieve. Everybody think they know what they're talking about, especially now. Everybody got an Instagram. Everybody got a Twitter following. Everybody got an opinion. Uneducated people, they ain't never read a book, think that they got something to say about everything. And so, getting people to agree together is not easy. It's not easy. Agreement is required. It's anointed. It's not easy. It's dependent on communication. We talked about all of this last Sunday, but one of the things that we did not talk about that I want to talk about now, even though I spent a bit of my time getting here, but that's all right. It's good anyhow. We didn't talk about the greatest agreement challenge. And one of the greatest agreement challenges is, you ready? You ready? Here it is. Agreement with God. Agreement with God. Greatest agreement challenge. If you think agreeing with your spouse is hard, try agreeing with God. You think agreeing with your child is hard. You think agreeing with your mama is hard. You think agreeing with your daddy is hard. You think agreement with your boss is hard. You think agreement with the CEO is hard. Might I suggest to you that agreement with God is more difficult than we let on. Because to agree with God, we have to be ready to come to grips with some truths about God that I'm going to throw on the screens for you really quickly because I'm a teacher. The first thing that we'll have to come to grips with is the personality of God. I'm going to give you some P's. I'm a preacher. The personality of God. To agree with God, we have to come to grips with the personality of God. Keep looking at the screen. To have agreement with God, we'll have to come to grips with the personality of God. Thank you very much. Number one. Number two. The perspective of God. If you're taking notes, you can just jot them down. The perspective of God, number two. Number three, the purpose of God. Number four, the power of God. And number five, the predictability, or better stated, the unpredictability of God. We spend so much time thinking about our personalities and our perspectives and our purpose and our power and our predictability or unpredictability. We spend so much time focusing on your personality and your perspective and your power and your purpose and your predictability or unpredictability. Very rarely do we take a step back and actually acknowledge that God has a personality and God has a perspective and God has a purpose and God has power and God is predictable and unpredictable at the same time. One of the great challenges of being in agreement with God, one of the great challenges of walking in fellowship with God outside of church, one of the reasons why church appeals to people more than God. It is possible to be so religious you don't have a real relationship with God. Because when you decide to have a relationship with God, you have to deal with the personality of God. And you have to deal with the perspective of God. And you have to deal with the purpose of God. God's purpose may be totally different than your perspective. You have to be prepared for how unlimited his power is. And you have to be prepared for the fact that he is predictable and unpredictable. Most people become overly religious and not relationship because they want this to be a remote control. I don't know if you've ever been in a relationship with somebody or been talking to someone and you wish you had a remote control for them. I know I'm not the one. You just wish you could hit pause, God, and then go get something. You wish you could mute. I don't know if you've ever just wish you could mute someone. I know you wish you could just fast forward through all this nonsense. You wish you could just back it up and play it again and hear them again. Unfortunately, people don't come with a remote control. Your girl don't come with a remote control. Be amazing if she did, but she does not come with a remote control. Your two-year-old does not come with a remote control. That'd be amazing. If you could hit sleep, oh my God, you would be a happy somebody if they just came with a remote control. Beloved, if people do not come with a remote control, you can take this Bible and point it at God and think you can push buttons all you want, as if you can control God with this book. Someone has tricked you into thinking that God is so simple that he can be manipulated by this book. You've got another thing coming. As a matter of fact, you've got to be careful, because too much control of spiritual power is witchcraft. And I would contend that along with our spirituality, we were taught witchcraft. We were taught what to do and what to sing and how to chant and how to lay and how to light a fire. We're not doing rain dances to make it rain. We're doing Holy Ghost dances to get some favor. Because we were taught a God that we want to be able to control. And I need an honest believer in this room, and I need an honest believer watching me around the world to be able to admit, anybody that's been walking with God for longer than 5 minutes will be able to admit, you cannot control God. Can you please raise your hand? Can you just wave at me and say, oh yeah, Pastor Andy, I learned that there are some things I asked for and he gave me, and there's some things I asked for he did not give me at all. I named it, claimed it, confessed it, believed it, conceived it, received it, believed. I did all the stuff they told me, and you know what? Where I am now is not where I thought I was going to be. As a matter of fact, it's even better. As a matter of fact, I'm so glad God did not listen to stupid old me. I'm so glad that I didn't use this like it was a spell book. This ain't Harry Potter, and you ain't got no wand. At some point, you have to realize this is an account of people that had to interact with the living God. Not Santa Claus, not a robot. The living God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. A God that you talk to and pray to and believe in and trust. A God that at the end of your prayer you say, but if it not, if it's your will, if you decide to do what I ask you to do, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. God, if it's possible, let this foolishness pass from me, but I want you to know, if you got a better plan for me, if you look down into the future and you know what you're doing, God, I want you to know, 'tis so sweet to trust you. And I realize that in all of my praying, I'm not in control of you. I think it's hard for God to be in a relationship with people who are trying to limit him to remote control buttons. I think that's hard. I think it's difficult. I don't know if anyone's ever asked you a question or suggested something to you that was so beneath you that you just thought to yourself, are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? I'm not even thinking like that. I think that God has a lot of interactions with us like that. When we look at Genesis 6 and we look at Noah, and I've never preached on Noah before. When we look at Noah, we have to come to grips with the personality of God and the perspective of God and the purpose of God and the power of God and the predictability and unpredictability of a living God. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, it says, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. I know I'm not the only one saying, help me, Jesus. Help us, Holy Ghost, for God to actually have a personality in which he's watching. I think this is one of the aspects of God's personality that we don't like to talk about a lot because it makes you nervous to know that he's watching. But God is watching. He's watching and he hears. Let's just let it marinate that his eye is on you and he hears you. I know I'm not the only one who has apologized to somebody, not because they deserved an apology, and not because I wanted to apologize, and not because I thought it was right to apologize, but because I know that God is watching me, and I know that God is listening to me, and I want God to be pleased, my God. I want the Lord to smile on me. And so I'm saying, well, Lord, maybe you put me in this apologetic situation simply because you want to see if I can humble myself. And then you said you resist the proud and give grace to the humble. So I'm going to apologize to this knucklehead person, even though they don't necessarily deserve an apology. What they really deserve is a kick in the head. But I am going to apologize to them because, God, I trust you see this. I say it all the time. Lord, you see this? You see what they did to me? You see how they talking to me? Now, Lord, you need to fix that. I don't know about you. I sit God on people all the time. I'm like, get him, get him, get him. Get them, Lord. On a regular basis, I'm like, Lord, you hear how they talk to your anointed. Lord, you hear how they talk to your child. Lord, you got to do something about this. I remember one of the first cars I ever owned. It was a hoopty. I can't believe it was so quiet when I said hoopty. Like y'all don't know what a hoopty is. Let me explain hoopty-ness for anyone watching that may not understand hoopty as a definition. A hoopty is a car that is paid for. Oh, I need a witness in the building. A hoopty is a car that you only have liability on. Talk to me. A hoopty is a car that you don't wash or wax because paint chips might fall off. A hoopty is a car where if something is rough, you get under there with a coat hanger and you tie your thing on there. A hoopty is a car where you have oil in the back because it needs a little oil all the time. A hoopty is a car that you don't play the music too loud because you need to hear what's going on with that car at all times. A hoopty is a car that's worth more to you than it is in the Kelley Blue Book. You look in Kelley Blue Book and they tell you that your car is worth $2,500. And you think to yourself, not to me. To me, this car is life itself. Your hoopty has got a name. You talk to it. Come on, Janet. You can get me there. Come on. You know we can make it. A hoopty gets you through. We owned a hoopty, and somebody stole my hoopty. Now, that tells you what kind of neighborhood you lived in. If you ever wonder, did Pastor Andy come up a little rough? I lived in a neighborhood where somebody stole my hoopty. It hurts your heart. Because there's no liability on it. They didn't steal it to drive it. They stole it for parts. When your car is worth more in pieces than it is as a whole, it's a hoopty. I walked outside. Hoopty was gone. First words out my mouth was, Lord,
potato stole your car because I decided to give everything to God, because if it's God's and somebody take it, then God must have to replace it. And since it's a hoopty, I'm expecting an upgrade. I speak an upgrade over everybody and their hoopty in the name of Jesus. But what I'm saying to you is God is listening. God is watching. God sees thoughts and hearts. It's a tough thing about God. God don't just look at what you do. He look at why. God actually looks and sees that every inclination of their heart is evil all the time. It's one of the scariest things about God. One of the most difficult things about being in agreement with God is that you can't really fool him. You can't really lie to him. Because he actually knows where your heart is. He actually knows what you meant when you said sorry. So when you get in the car, you have to have an honest conversation with him and say, now, Lord, I said sorry to them because I want you to be happy with me. But to tell you the truth, God, I'm not sorry at all. As a matter of fact, what I really want them to do is burn up in a fire. No, Lord, what I really want them to do is lose everything. You have a real relationship with God. You can't lie. I've actually said to people, you need to be careful with how you deal with me and how I deal with you, because my mouth will say, oh, I'm praying for you, but my heart is a whole nother thing. I wish I had a witness in the building of somebody that can say, my mama taught my mouth what to say, but my heart is different. My mama taught my mouth to say thank you, but my heart was not grateful. My mama taught my mouth to say, hope you have a good day, but my heart said, hope you trip. I was taught to be polite and say, oh, good for you. And on the inside saying, get them, God, get them. You know they nasty. You know they stink. God don't like ugly. And you mean and ugly. So I rebuke you. I know it's so I have to be honest with God about my heart. Because God knows thoughts and hearts. God can read your mind. If you're sitting next to somebody that you care about, raise your hand. You sit next to somebody you care about, raise your hand. Okay, hallelujah. Aren't you glad they can't read your mind? Bro, you can nod. You can just, bro, you don't have to nod. You can just wink. You can just. Aren't you glad your mama can't read your mind? Some of us got popped for what our mama thought we meant. I could tell on your face. I was thinking, if you could only read my mind, you'd know. You'd be tripping on the stairs. What I'm saying to you is God can know your thoughts. And he's actually recording it. This is hard, Elder Clark. This is hard. The Bible says that we'll have to give an account for every thoughtless word. You ever been watching a pro game, bruh, and you see somebody do something stupid on the field or on the court, and you think to yourself, dude, there's cameras everywhere. How did you think you were going to get away with that? Beloved, every word we say is being recorded. Ooh. Let's ask God to forgive us right now so he can erase the tape. Aren't you glad the Bible says he casts all sin into a sea of forgiveness and remembers it no more? Let's do a disc erase real quick. Lord, forgive us for everything we said. Everybody just wave. Lord, forgive me for what I said. Lord, forgive me for that I cussed yesterday. Lord, forgive me for that word. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, the disc is erased. No, I need you to clap. The Bible says, blessed is the person whose sin is covered. No, I need you to praise God that we just erase your disc. If nothing else happened, your disc got erased because you said something yesterday that you had no business saying. Woo. Not only does God's heart, the personality of God, and the perspective of God, is that not only does God listen, but it's possible for God to have regrets. Elder Noah said, the Bible says in Genesis about Noah that God regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. Anybody in this room have a regret? Let's be honest. Raise your hand. You have a regret? No. Wave at me so I know you are honest. Oh, Pastor Andy, I've got some regrets. It's okay, because God had regret. God's heart was actually troubled. To agree with God, we have to come to grips with the personality of God and the perspective of God, that if we go too far, God can almost question why we're even here. I'm constantly saying, Lord, let my good outweigh my bad. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart. Lord, on a regular basis, I'm saying, Lord, if you let them kill me, who gonna praise you? Lord, who gonna give? Who gonna sow? Who gonna be faithful? Lord, I don't want you to regret that you even sent me here. The Lord said, I'm going to wipe everybody off the face of the earth. This is the story of Noah. I don't know how much you believe it, but I think the story is apropos to the personality of God and the perspective of God and the power of God. For him to say, I'm killing everybody. This is a part of the personality of God. He's a loving God. He's a merciful God. He's slow to anger. He's abounding in compassion and mercy. And his grace is sufficient. At the same time, he'll get mad and want to kill everybody. It's not the first time. It's the same God. Read your Bible. The Lord's anger is slow, but it's real. And I think it's something for us to discuss. Gentlemen, in this sugary, overly sensitive, scared to hurt anybody's feelings world, in which we are halfway terrified for anybody to come to grips with any kind of anger, but not all anger is bad. God got angry. God can get angry. I don't want to make God angry. God can get angry. Verse 8. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. No matter what's going on in the wickedness around you, no matter what's happening in the world you live in, no matter who all is upsetting the personality of God and his power and his perspective, his purpose, no matter who is thwarting God's purpose, no matter whether or not you can predict God or not predict God, if the Lord says, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I, if the Lord decides to send his rain on the just or the unjust, if the Lord decides to bless somebody that you think has no business being blessed, regardless of the personality of God, one of the things of God's personality and purpose and power, his perspective and his predictability and unpredictability, is in all of the mess, you can find favor with God. I speak favor. I speak Noah favor over all of us. in the name of Jesus. I speak the favor of Noah over all of us in the name of Jesus. I just right now speak a Noah blessing over all of us. In the name of Jesus Christ, I speak favor on us. I speak it for all of us who are reading the paper and watching the news and looking at the world and looking at the storm and looking at the heat and thinking about the climate and thinking about revelations and thinking about the world and is it about to be destroyed? Beloved, I just want you to know it's absolutely possible to find favor with God. Anybody believe in God for favor? Anybody believe in God for favor? My prayer is that we will acknowledge that favor with God can be found. That it is possible even in your imperfection. To find favor with God. Even though you don't always do right, you can find favor. Even though you don't always say the right stuff, you can still find favor. Even though you don't know exactly where you're going, you can still find favor. And favor is one word away. All you need to have favor with God is faith. Faith is your equalizer. Faith is the thing that gets counted as righteousness. Faith is the thing that so moves God that even when you ain't right, and even when you don't talk right, and even when you don't do right, and even when you don't act right, God likes faith in Him so much that God has a thing for faith in somebody. If you believe He's able, if you believe He's got a plan, if you believe He's talking to you, if you believe your ladder will be greater, if you believe that the God you serve is able to deliver you, if you believe that what's coming is better than what's been, God will look at you and say, look at them believing in spite of the circumstances. God just likes faith. They asked Jesus, what must we do to do the works that God requires? And Jesus says, the work of God is this, to believe. To believe. It's not to be perfect. It's not to be perfectly holy because your righteousness is as filthy rags. It's not to do everything right all the time. It's not to always make all the right decisions. It's not to never make no mistakes. That's not what it is. It is for you to turn your face to God and say, Lord, I still believe that you are able to deliver. I still believe that you are able to bless. I'm about to go in here. I have been turned down for 5 positions. I'm about to go in here and apply for the 6th one because I believe that God has a plan for my life. I believe that I'm getting ready to go somewhere. I believe that what the Bible says is true. I believe that He said He'd make me the head and not the tail, above only and not beneath. I believe that I will be at the top and not at the bottom. And I might be at the bottom right now, but I know a scripture that says the last shall be first and the first shall be last. So if I'm last now, I'm about to be first. God about to turn this thing around for me. If you have an attitude like that, God like that. God just got something in His heart for folk who just think He can do exceedingly, abundantly, above all. God just got something in His mind about somebody who's sitting there waiting for God to show up, saying, that's all right, God's about to show up. That's all right, it look like I don't have it, but God's about to show up. What, they said no? Yeah, well, hold on a second. Let me have a little talk with Jesus. Let me talk to my God, because the God I serve is able to deliver me. Listen, Nebuchadnezzar, the God I serve is able to deliver me. And you know what? He will deliver me. Out your hands. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he would talk against the armies of God? I don't have to have the right armor. I don't have to have the right sword. I don't have to have the right shield. Just give me my sling and a couple of stones, because I believe that my God is able. I believe that he can do anything but fail. Who am I talking to in this room? I have found that what is required for favor is faith. And it's why you're in this room. It's why you're watching around the world. It's because somewhere deep down on the inside, there's something you just won't let go. There's a part of you that's like, I can't let go till he bless me. There's a part of you that's like, well, I might as well pray. There's a part of you that's like, well, I might as well trust God because he's able. I want you to know that nugget of faith makes God pay attention. People in this book were not perfect people. The people in this book were people who heard God and believed. And all you have to do is be a believer. And you can find favor. And I pray for favor on you on a regular basis. And I pray for favor on you right now. I pray that favor will rest on you. I pray that favor will rest on you so thick that it'll get on your children's children. I pray that your children's children will have stuff working for them that they can't even really explain. As a matter of fact, the reason why I know it's possible to pray for this is because there are people in the room with me right now that you are walking in prayers that you did not pray. Something has worked for you. The door opened for you. You aren't necessarily walking in your own favor. You're walking in your mama's prayers. You're walking in your granddaddy's prayers. It's favor. I'm praying that as a result of your faith in God, that favor will chase you down. Because the first main lesson of Noah is not just that God has this personality and we've got to agree with God, and the thing that's unique about Noah, and I'm done. The thing that's unique about Noah, I'm not done, but I'm out of time. But the thing that's unique about Noah is the one dude in this moment who was able to agree with God. And I want to challenge you this morning, beloved, in spite of the circumstances, agree with God. A kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. A house divided against itself cannot stand. It is almost impossible for you to have God in your house and you don't agree with him. And God can only do but so much if you won't agree with him. He can only give you but so many promises if you won't agree. He said, I got a plan for you. It's not to harm you. It's to give you hope and a future. He said to you that he'll bless you in the city. He'll bless you in the field. He'll bless you when you come. He'll bless you when you go. He said, if you seek the kingdom first, I'm quoting scripture to somebody. He said, if you seek the kingdom first and my righteousness, everything else will be added unto you as well. And all we have to do is believe. Now, God, I pray that you'd make us believers and not doubters. God, I pray that your anointing would rest on us. I pray, God, that not only will you put favor on us, but that our faith would come alive. I pray we would give in faith, believing. I pray that we would move in faith, believing. I pray, God, that our faith would speak louder than our fears.
forgive us for every thoughtless word. Lord, we can say those words are cuss words, but what they really are, God, is doubt words. Where we spoke doubt and we spoke fear and we talked about what you couldn't do. God, forgive us. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And like Noah, God, we want to just agree with you. You tell us it's going to rain, we believe you. We're done arguing with you, we'll believe you. We'll trust you. Put our lives in your hands. You do all things well. Thank you for living so big in us today. Thank you for your anointing that destroys the yoke. Use us for your glory. Saturate us with faith. Saturate us with favor. Lord, if I did an altar call for faith, I wouldn't even be able to pray because I need more faith as the labors increase. Lord, in the room, charge us with faith. Across the screens, charge us with faith. May the faith of God, not just faith in God, but the faith of God, the faith that calls those things that be not as though they were. May that faith come alive in us right now. Restore our faith and connect us with favor, and we'll praise you in Jesus' name. We all sit together. If you heard a word from the Lord, let me get you to give. No, don't clap. I always get you to clap. If you heard a word from the Lord, let's give to the work of the kingdom of God. This is our building fund offering, and you're donating toward Victory Park. We're on our way out of here. We're on our way to a wealthy place, and we are moving quickly and supposed to break ground in another month or so. And we are on schedule, on task, and you know, our lease is up in this space. And beloved, we have maximized the ministry in this space. We have been in this space here for 10 years. And we've been in RTP now since 2007. But this space here, we moved into this sanctuary in 2012. And we've done all kinds of ministry in this space, jammed this space out 2 and 3 and 4 times, and have baptized, and people have gotten saved in these spaces. And what has happened now is we've just reached a plateau in this ministry, in this space. The space is now limiting us from being able to do everything that God is calling for us to do. And so we are on our way to our own home. And you can take that picture and you can give through that portal, or you can raise your hand and somebody will come and give you an offering envelope. We're about to pass the bucks in just a second, but we're on our way out of here. And on our way to this Victory Park, and we're building a sanctuary. And really, it's a building that's about 100,000 square feet. We're going to have a sanctuary around this size. And but then the rest of it is just going to be basketball courts and sports arena and a place for kids and fields on the outside and counseling center space and guidance counseling. And it's going to be a place in which it's going to be our new home. And we're going to praise God, and we're going to have a worship center second to none there. And we're going to broadcast kingdom to the world from that space, but also we're going to minister to the community from that space. And I need you to help me as we walk by faith and not by sight. And so whatever you give in this offering is going to World Overcomers. And everything you give is going to the kingdom of God. And if you're watching around the world, I need you to join with me and give and be faithful to give to the house of God. And the Bible says that if you give to the poor, you lend to the Lord. And so not only are you just giving to the church of God, and the Bible says to bring the tithes and the offerings to the storehouse so that they could be meat in the house of God. And God don't need my money. You're right. God doesn't need your money, but the house does. The church does. The kingdom does. And we are fighting a battle to establish a work. And we've established a work, but now we are about to take territory that's going to count for God. It's going to be right on 70, and we're going to have curb appeal and
and all of it. What stuff, all the things that we don't have here, parking that's not interrupted, and signage and all the stuff. And for all of you that come to this church and how you found us, thank you that for making fine. Thank you for following the map. But the new space is just going to be everything that we have needed. And don't get me wrong, we've done amazing ministry here, but the time is up. It's time for us to get out of this building. And so we're on our way. And so your giving goes to that. That's the vision. And I appreciate you for your faithfulness. Come on, let's pray. Lord, thank you for this opportunity that we have to give. God, we know that you said in your word that you would bless our basket and our store. And so, God, not only are we believing for through our tithes, but God, also through our offering, we give above and beyond just what we owe you. We give above and beyond our tithes. We give an offering to your house, and we're believing you for exponential blessing. We're in this room and around the world, the global World Overcomers membership group. We come together and we're establishing this building here in Durham, and then God, after that, the best is yet to come. And so we bless you for what you're doing. Have your way in us. Kingdom of God, come in us. Will of God be done in us right now, in Jesus' name. We all sit together. God bless you as you give. As the bucket passes you, just stay on your seat for just a second. Let all these faithful armor bearers and gatekeepers come and just serve you. And gentlemen, if you'd like to serve, we need men to serve and continue to help serve. It's not hard at all for you to join and be a part of the gatekeepers and the armor bearers. And it's something that we only let men do. We feel like this is a time for men to be counted and seen in the church. And we let women do all of the leading and everything in the church for so much. And it's time for men to really lead. And so men have been leading at World Overcomer since we started it. 48% of our church is men. So gentlemen, if you would like to serve, just a blue shirt is the beginning. But we need you to volunteer. All of our areas of ministry still need volunteers. And from media to children's ministry to gatekeepers to care, all of it. And as I said earlier, you're not just here to be served, but to serve. Amen? And it's your time and your tithe and your talent. And so if you've got a talent, you've got a gift, we want you to be able to use that for the work of the kingdom of God. Perhaps you have come to the kingdom for just such a time as this, and we are excited that you gave. All right, jump on your feet. Let's pray. Lord, thank you. 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 Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so full, so free. Thank you for this crowd that gathered. They're too great to number. Thank you for everyone that they represent. We pray that favor would be on them so thick that it would even touch their parents and their children and their grandchildren and their neighbors. God, we pray that the world will be blessed through us. Thank you for everyone that watched this service and everyone that will watch this sermon. God, we pray that your anointing would touch them wherever they may be. God, we pray, as we always pray, that you will bless your people, that you will strengthen your people, that you will feed your people, that you'll put grace on your people, that you'll put favor on your people. And we pray, God, that your grace will be sufficient for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And God, we pray that the words of our mouth, thank you that we erased our disc today, and the meditations of our heart will be acceptable in your sight. Oh God, our rock, our redeemer, we love you. In Jesus' name, we all sit together. Amen. God bless you. Thanks for coming to church today. Thanks for tuning in with us today. See you next week. No.
say. Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God saves.
Our God saves.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
We give thanks.
We give thanks.
I'm grateful.
I'm grateful for who you are and all you do.
Never failed me yet. Good to me, and I'm grateful. where you had it. Hey, if he did it before, he could do it again. If he did it before, he could do it again.
Can I get a witness up in here?
It's starting and my bills are due. My 3-month-old baby needs some shoes. Can't you feel what I'm going through? Clock on the wall keeps ticking, talking, no stopping, and somebody's knocking on the door telling me to go.
Lord have mercy.
Brother, I can't take no more. So with my knees I hit the floor.
Well, come on, y'all.
Let's go down by the riverside.
Woo!
Leave your problem far behind. You can rest from mind.
everybody, Jesus is going to meet us down there by the riverside. One time for your holy mind. Come on up in here. Into a new thing.
You can rest your mind.
We're gonna go rest in that family.